Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the first meeting of the Health and Sport Committee of 2017, and a belated Happy New Year to everyone. Could I ask everyone to switch off or switch their mobile phones on to silent? It's acceptable to use mobile phones for social media, but not for photographs, filming or recording. As per our official agenda, we have already covered items 1 and 4 in private this morning, so we move on to agenda item 5, which is subordinate legislation. We have two negative instruments to consider today. The first is the Regulation of Care Prescribed Registers Scotland Amendment Order 2016, SSI 2016413. There has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Can I invite any comments from members? No. Has the committee agreed to make no recommendations? Thank you. That's agreed. Thank you very much. The second instrument is the Casings and Casinets Scotland Number 2 Regulations 2016 SSI 2016422. There has been no motion to annul. However, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee have made comments on the instrument. They've drawn the regulations to the attention of Parliament on reporting ground JAI. The instrument fails to comply with the requirements of Section 28.2 of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2010, although this does not affect the validity of the instrument. Regulations were laid before Parliament on the 15th December and come into force on the 21st and 22nd. They do not respect the requirement that at least 28 days should elapse between the laying of an instrument which is subject to the negative procedure and the coming into force of that instrument. As regards its interest in the Scottish Government's decision to proceed in this matter, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee finds the failure to comply with Section 28 to be acceptable in the circumstances following. Could I ask if there's any comments from members? No. Has the committee agreed to make no recommendations?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Agenda item 6, we have a session with the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman. Thank you very much for your attendance this morning. We have Jim Martin, the Ombudsman, Nicky McLean, Director, and John Stevenson, Head of Complaints and Standards. The Ombudsman has agreed not to make an opening statement, so we'll just start with questions. I wonder if I could begin maybe by just asking you to very briefly explain your role and your experiences over the last year or so.
The Scottish Public Services Ombudsman is the last port of call for people who have got complaints which are unresolved about public services in Scotland. We have a very wide remit. We deal with the National Health Service, with government, local government, prisons, water, and so it goes on. We deal with health in a way that's different from the other public sector areas that we have, because in health we have the power to look at clinical judgment. And that means that I have to take advice from professionals in all the different disciplines in a lot of the cases which come to me. That power doesn't exist in, for example, local authorities, and for example, in higher education, further education schools. I can't look at academic judgment, that kind of thing. So in health, there's a particular power that I currently have. As you'll have seen from the papers we've given you, over the last year, we've had a significant increase in the number of health complaints which are coming to us. It's maybe worth saying to people who are not familiar with the Ombudsman Office, people can normally only come to the Ombudsman once they have been through the complaints process in the public body concerned. So if someone comes to us early, we call that premature complaints, what we'd normally do is signpost them to the appropriate place and have them take their complaint through that. Once that complaint has been through all the process at the local level, so at GP level, dentist practice level, health board level, if people are still dissatisfied with the outcome, they can bring it to us. So as I say, last year we had about a 9% increase in the number of complaints coming to us. Since I became Ombudsman in 2009, the increase in health complaints is around 75% over that period. And there are lots of reasons for that, which I'm sure you'll want to maybe discuss. The uphold rate, that is the cases which we investigate, and we find that there's something which should have happened that didn't happen, is currently running for most public services in Scotland, coming to me, about 50%. In health, it's about 56%. The worrying thing about that is that these are cases which have already been investigated at a local level. So an investigation has been conducted at a local level. Complaints have been not upheld, by and large, and brought to me. We've investigated, in more than half the cases, we find fault. It's sometimes the case that a complaint may even have been upheld at the local level, but not fully to the satisfaction of the complainant. In some cases, we will look at these cases. If we find that the whole thing hasn't been investigated properly, we'll look at it. If we find that it has and there's nothing more we can do for people, we'll tell them, and that will close the matter. The proportion of cases that we see overall that health takes up has increased over that period. So health is the fastest growing area of complaints that come to my office. It is now second behind local government, and I would anticipate if the rates keep continuing the way they're going, then health may well be on a par with or overtake local government in the next 2 to 3 years. I have to say the cases that we're seeing, in my opinion, are more complex now than we're perhaps seeing in early stages. So that more and more we are having to send away for advice, maybe from 2 or 3 different specialisms to look at a particular case. And that's an issue of concern, because you will see in the report I gave you, this is beginning to sound like an opening statement, I'm sorry about that, but you'll see that we do have an issue over the provision of clinical advice, where the Parliamentary and Health Service Ombudsman has decided that an arrangement, that's the one that deals with England, has decided that after 23 years that they do not feel they can give us clinical advice or access to their clinical advice anymore, which I'll say more about later if someone asks me the right question, which is leading us to having to create in Scotland our own bank of clinical advisors. So over the last year, convener, we've seen an increase in health complaints. The uphold rate is still quite high. We're having to rethink how we get advice to investigate cases. But we've also been working alongside the National Health Service to help them to put in a new complaint handling procedure for the National Health Service, which will go live in April. And that will put the National Health Service complaints process onto the same standardised procedure as the rest of public service in Scotland. And because we've argued long and hard that if you're going to have health and social integration coming together, that you need to have one complaint procedure to go through everything, the social work complaints process will be brought in line with that as well from the 1st of April. So from the 1st of April, we should have a user-centred complaints process which is standardised, which enable local authorities and health boards to work together to solve issues when they arise. It should also give this committee better information about the number and nature of complaints that are coming forward in health, but also in health and social care integration. And I think that will then place Scotland in a better position than any other parliament in the United Kingdom, certainly, I would argue, in Europe, in that we will be able to look across the whole of our public services in Scotland and be able to see from a complaints perspective what is happening, what areas are leading to complaints from the public, how they've been managed, how different health boards, local government bodies, universities, housing associations, prisons, how everyone is dealing with that. And so the raw information that you will have at your disposal as a committee to help you to get underneath what is bothering the public about the provision of public services will be something that I hope that you will mine in the future. John Stevenson, who's the architect of most of that stuff, will happily answer questions on it. And Nicky McLean will will do the stuff with the numbers. I just do the blarney at the front.
Your non-opening statement. You're saying that 56% of the health cases that you looked at were upheld, having already gone through either an NHS complaints system. Is that an indication of an NHS system that's broken?
I think if you look at the Scottish Health Council's report in 2014, making it better, they had a few concerns about the way that the health complaint system was working. And they asked that the health service work with us to put in place a better process for handling complaints, which will give us a new national complaints handling procedure. Areas where I think the health service is improving but could go further. I'm not convinced that the management of complaints is given the weight that it should be given in health boards in particular, and in general practitioners, I'm absolutely convinced that that's the case. If you look back at the Francis report into mid-staffs, part of what Robert Francis highlighted was his discussions with the chair of that health trust. And he put it to the chair of the health trust that a lot of the issues that arose that led to the deaths of so many people had been flagged up in the complaint system, but the chair and the chief executive and the board of the trust had neglected that. And essentially what the chair said was, you know, well, there'll always be complaints. And we know there'll always be complaints, and they don't really add anything. And Francis's view was that if you take that approach, then you miss out on early warning and learning. And where I think the National Health Service in Scotland is getting better is an understanding that when complaints are brought, they're not necessarily something which should be looked at on the basis of potential reputational damage, which when I came in to office, one or two health boards definitely saw my office as a threat to their reputations. It is not a matter for lawyers, because in my view, we're moving away in Scotland, you know, over the last couple of years at least, from lawyers saying, for goodness sake, don't say sorry. For goodness sake, don't admit anything in case that 0.04% of complaints end up in court and we end up in litigation. We're moving away from that. I think the health service is getting better at that. It's getting better at knowing that they have to investigate complaints. I would hope that once the new processes are in, the new procedures are in, and the work that Nicky McLean's doing with health boards and others on learning from complaints, that the uphold rate that I see or my successor sees, because I'll be leaving office soon, that my successor sees will fall. I do see a willingness in the National Health Service to grasp this and to learn from it. But I have to say, the machinery of the National Health Service sometimes looks to me as if it's been oiled with treacle, because things take so long, you know, to come through. In this case, I think they moved relatively quickly in the complaint handling procedures. Still slow, but relatively quickly. And hopefully from the 1st of April, we'll have a better system in place.
Just as a follow-up for that, in terms of the culture and the attitudes that prevail, sometimes within very senior managers within the NHS, in my experiences representing constituents, and who are both practitioners within the health service but also patients, is that very often it appears as though there's a culture of closing things down and denial rather than an acceptance that there's a problem, and a capacity within the health service at a very senior level to claim that white is black and black is white. Do you sense that that has been there in the past, and is it still there, or do you sense that there's an opportunity and they're grasping that opportunity for real change so that we do learn from mistakes and are open about those mistakes and those complaints?
I think it's wrong to look at all health boards and suggest that they're the same, because I think the culture in different health boards is different, and In 2009-10, if you'd asked me, I wouldn't name names for a minute, if you don't mind, I'll say why later. I would have said there were a couple of health boards who would fit nearly the description that you're saying. The first, you know, port of call would be no. Yeah, say nothing, you know, nothing to see here, please move on. But also, this is paradoxical, where the National Health Service, I think, also in the past has been, and this is going to sound really, really silly, unprofessional, is that it hasn't been good in some cases at closing things down. So on the one hand, I think I would have said 5 years ago that consultants in hospitals, for example, had far more power over what happened to complaints than they ever should have, and that the investigation within a lot of health boards was not up to scratch, particularly of worker consultants. On the other hand, in some cases where it was in the best interests of everyone, families included, to close something down, the health service would attempt to go the extra mile, would drag a process out without coming to a conclusion, and would lead families to come to me and say, the National Health Service have been investigating this case for over a year now. And when I look at the detail, I can see, no, they haven't. What they've done is they've investigated it. They've got to the point where they can take a decision, but I've tried to help the family by going and getting them another bit of information, another bit of information, another bit of information, and not giving closure. So across the board, I think that in terms of handling complaints, it's been a curate's egg as far as various boards are concerned. I think that culture is changing, and I think the Scottish Health Council deserves a lot of credit for, as we used to say where I come from, putting their foot in the ball in 2014 and say, hold on a minute, you know, what are we actually doing here? Because that has enabled them to look at what their complaints process should be, how they should go about investigating complaints, what the status of the people handling complaints should be, and in post Francis reports, Ness and the boards got together and asked us to help them with master classes so that non-executives in health boards understood the central role that complaints played in governance in the National Health Service. So I think over the last 2 years, there's been that pressure from the boards down. There's been a move towards getting the procedures improved. And I think that will lead to a change in culture. But I agree with you, convener, there's still a bit to go in a lot of health boards. And the case, for example, of your own area, we recently had to say to Lothian Health Board that we were not happy with the way that they were managing the complaints process generally. And if you look at the minutes of that board, you'll see that they're now grappling with how they can improve that. Now, that may have been a fight 5 years ago. Now it's, and I pay some credit to the chair for this, it's a case of we really need to get this fixed in the interests of patients and their families.
Well then, Ivan.
Thank you very much. Two questions. The first is to ask you about the reasons behind what appears to be a very significant rise in health-related complaints, not just over the last year, but as you say in your letter, over the last 5 years. And secondly, to get your observations, please, on the fact that on page 2 of your letter, it's clinical issues and hospitals which far outstrip, it seems, regularly any other issue. And I just wondered if you could explore that for the committee.
I'm happy to take that question. In terms of the rising volumes at SPSOCs, that it very much mirrors the rise in complaints recorded within health boards themselves. I think we have to be careful about making the presumption that rising volumes in complaints in and of themselves is necessarily a bad thing. What it can mean is that it can be a recognition of an increasing confidence in a complaint system. So I think in and of itself, a rising volume in recording of complaints, and John, my colleague, might want to say a bit more about that in terms of the Complaint Standards Authority role. But certainly what SPSO sees is a reflection of what is happening within NHS boards themselves. With regards to your second question, I think you're absolutely right. I think that we see a relatively low number of complaints, for example, about GP services compared to the number of people that are accessing GP services. I think part of that is about access to complaints processes, because these are small practices that would not necessarily receive high volumes, and I think that the processes for processing complaints within health boards will be more established. And I think that there is potentially underreporting of complaints within areas like the GP sector.
Can I just add to that? You have to remember a number of things. I mean, the Patients' Rights Act came in, and you can argue how much was in that act that actually changed, but what it did do was raise the profile of people having the rights to do it. Since 2011, Parliament has given my office the, in fact, we were the first in the UK, to publish decisions. So you'll now see in newspapers, you know, decisions being upheld and stuff. And I'm particularly pleased that you see these in local newspapers. And I think that's encouraging people to come forward, and I think that's important. I think when you start to look at underneath the numbers, as John will tell you, it becomes difficult. And what I always ask committees to remember is I only see the tip of the iceberg here. The cases that come to us, you know, we see a relatively small number of the total number of complaints. So you've got to be very careful about reading strategically across from what we're seeing.
Thanks very much. It's fascinating. There was a number of things just through the process I wanted to just touch on. I was going to ask about how many of the complaints were hidden, if you like, and you've kind of answered that. And I get the feeling that you don't really know how many are hidden, and that'll obviously develop over time. This 56% that are upheld, so those complaints have been through a process within the health board themselves and then come to you. Do you have data on what's happening within the health boards in terms of how many complaints they're seeing and what their metrics are in terms of how many they are dealing with or not dealing with, and how many of those come on to you?
Well, yes, we have data from the Information Services Directorate of the NHS to see how many complaints are being received and recorded year on year. And I think it is fair to say there has been a rise year on year up until the last year when there was a slight decrease. One of the issues around the listening and learning report from the Scottish Health Council was the consistent use of performance information and information about complaints handling. And one of their recommendations, which, you know, the main recommendation led to the development of a new procedure that Jim speaks about, but within that, one of the recommendations was to look afresh at the data sets being captured and recorded by ISD to bring it up to date, not only with the information that's been recorded across a wider public sector, but to make sure that it's in line with the new complaints procedure. So moving forward, we will have a far more detailed, a far better understanding of the complaints that are being recorded by boards and by primary care providers, not only what they're about, but importantly, what the learning from those complaints are, because I personally was very encouraged that in working with professionals from the NHS, when we looked at performance reporting, they themselves identified the learning and improvement from complaints as the number one key indicator. And you'll find that the new complaints procedure that comes into place from April highlights that within the performance reporting, that the number one issue to report against is the learning and recording from complaints. So I think it's fair to say that moving forward, we will have a far better understanding, not only of the number of complaints being received, but what they're about and what the outcomes are. And just to pick up on one other issue there, you talked about the hidden complaints. I think that perhaps not only in the NHS, but across the public sector, there has been an issue of issues that are complaints that are not actually being recorded as complaints. So where somebody expresses some real dissatisfaction about a service that's been provided, historically, at least, there has been a tendency to certainly resolve that issue in a professional way, but not record that it was raised. And therefore, if you don't record it, you lose the opportunity to learn. There has been a change in the NHS, certainly, and that maybe explains in part the rise in complaints numbers, but also across the wider public sector, to rigidly apply the definition of a complaint, which is an expression of dissatisfaction, and to record that so that the organisation can learn going forward.
You don't have any data as such then on how many complaints have been made to health boards, how many of those are getting dealt with satisfactorily there, how many of those are then coming on to you, and what that percentage is?
Yeah, well, in terms of raw numbers, we know that circa 21,000 complaints have been made in the year 2015-16, and we can tell you how many complaints come to SPSO.
It's about 1,500.
So
90-odd% are getting dealt with at the health board level?
Of course.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay.
As Jim says, it's the tip of the iceberg that comes.
Yeah. It's maybe worth just playing with that number for a minute. I mean, I've got real concerns about whether, you know, how robust these numbers are. But if you look at the health number, which is about 21,000, the local government number over the same period is 62,000. Now, I don't know how that feels to you, you know, but that kind of suggests that in health we're seeing 60 complaints a day, and in local government we're seeing 180 per day. Now, what I'm hoping is that once we get everybody onto the same system, you know, we can maybe begin to look at these numbers a bit more scientifically, and you have better data in which to begin to advocate policy changes.
Yeah. And was around this 56%. I'm assuming there's a spread across different health boards there. Is there, I don't want to use the word sanction, but is there any kind of league table measure kickback to the health board to say your percentage is too high, you're not dealing with this stuff upstream well enough, and you're letting too much of it come downstream to us? Or is that just kind of accepted as the way things are?
No. I've intervened with a couple of health boards, one of which is, as I mentioned earlier, is Lothian. And the way that we look at that is we look at three things. We look at the rate of upholds that we have coming through. That's things that they've looked at, that we've looked at, and we've come to a different conclusion. We've looked at the volume of complaints and whether relatively, given the size of that health board, that's kind of what we'd expect or not. And the level of premature complaints, that's people who come to us when they should really have gone to the health board in the first instance. And you do a kind of wee algorithm and you come up with a figure. So that if a health board gets to the point where they're around 70%, I'm upholding 70% over a period, I will have an informal chat with them. If that number doesn't come down, I'll have a formal chat with the officials. And if that number still doesn't come down, I'll have a very formal chat with the board.
So in the last point I wanted to touch on, I mean, my background is in consultancy and manufacturing, where this stuff is done to death. I mean, continuous improvement is a way of life, because if you don't do that, you don't survive. And listen to this, some of this stuff, it's like a throwback to 30 years ago, to where we were in that environment. It's good to hear you're saying all the right stuff in terms of where it needs to go in terms of process improvements. I suppose I'm interested to hear how many of the complaints as such move on to become implemented as process improvements. But also moving that forward, even the language of complaints is a bit kind of, I mean, we tend to talk about opportunities for improvement or improvement suggestions, etc. Is there a process there that allows people to say this could be better, and I want to make an improvement suggestion rather than a complaint as such? Because the whole complaint thing is obviously tarred with the implication that somebody did something wrong, rather than there's a process thing that we could fix.
So in terms of process improvement, I think it's important to remember that the Ombudsman initially was established, and that the heart of the Ombudsman service is about individual redress. So fundamentally, our first priority is try to put things right for that individual and their families. Saying that, 60% of the recommendations that we make through our casework are improvement-related recommendations. And I think that increasingly that is where we should be focusing our attention, to make sure that you're getting that as much value for money, as much improvement as you possibly can from those recommendations. Obviously, it's very much back to health boards about how they use that to drive wider improvement. But some of the work that we're now doing through our Learning and Improvement Unit is very much on encouraging and supporting health boards to ensure that they get maximum benefit from the recommendations that we're making. We don't have systemic powers to follow complaints and investigate more widely, and we are also seeking more powers to be able to share the information that we hold in regards to learning, and I think that would be of real benefit.
Thank In working with NHS professionals over the last year, it's been my experience that they do aspire to be this open and learning organisation that values all forms of feedback. And you asked if there was other processes. So within the Patient Rights Act at the moment, there is a requirement to record all forms of feedback. So feedback, comments, concerns and complaints. So complaints, you're right, have a certain connotation. But I know that boards and primary care providers are also recording concerns and comments and feedback and use that information to improve services.
Thank you. Thanks.
Arnold, thank you for coming to see us, and I'm very grateful for the existence of your office. I've certainly referred a number of constituents to you when they've reached the end of the line in terms of complaints, particularly with NHS Lothian in health circumstances. I'd like to pick up on Ivan's last question about learning and application of learning. I had a constituent come to see me yesterday. His name is Dr. Patrick Statham. He's a neurosurgeon from the Western General in Edinburgh. And he was very concerned that he felt that the levels of cancellations in his ward due to the unavailability of beds because of the lack of ring fencing in the neurology department was getting to the stage where, you know, his morale, the morale of his fellow surgeons was really plummeting because they kept having to turn people away. This is clearly a systemic problem, which will undoubtedly lead to complaints to your office. And it's clear that there is a mix of systemic complaints and complaints about individual practice or care. But I just wondered if you could explore a little bit further about, in terms of the application and recommendations you make, how much you look to other sort of health sectors that have solved these problems in the past. And I say that because Patrick pointed to St Thomas's Hospital in London, which had exactly the same problem with their neurosurgery department, and actually brought in KPMG as a management consultant to look at how better to deploy those beds. And they came up with the very simple idea that we ring fence the beds for neurosurgery. It didn't really impact on the rest of the hospital, but it meant that people got seen for elective surgery. And just wondered if you could give us your reflections on learning from other places, because these problems are clearly not unique to Scotland.
So I think that it's fair to say that the complaints that we see are not complaints about systemic issues, is the first thing that I would say. Neurology, we actually, that's not your question, but we don't see a high volume of complaints about neurology. In terms of our recommendations stem from the use of clinical advisors who are in practice. They refer to relevant SIGN or NICE guidelines and other areas of good practice. So what we are doing is assessing the reasonableness of the actions of the clinicians and other medical experts against national guidance. And so that's really where we take our advice from.
Can I just add just a little to that? Because we were at the local government committee the other day, and I was using the opportunity of my last annual report to suggest ways in which the powers that the Ombudsman have might be augmented to enable better sharing of information so that there can be, you know, issues can be picked up. And one of the areas, although I haven't used that term, that we look at, we see things frequently occurring. You know, I can think of one hospital that we saw in Fife, I think, a few years ago now, where we were concerned. We'd seen a number of radiography cases coming through with the same flaw. Technically, I could look at each of these cases on their own and come to a decision on each of these cases on their own and presumably make recommendations about each of these cases on their own. But clearly, there was an issue there which was more systemic. And I think by enabling my successor to be able to share information with regulators, which we currently are precluded from doing in our legislation, will enable us to take a more joined up approach across Scotland in issues, where issues arise that the Ombudsman sees that can then be tackled. Because if we were to operate simply on the letter of our act, we wouldn't be allowed to do that. And I think that is something that various committees of the Parliament might want to think about when the Local Government Committee, I hope, takes forward these suggestions we've made about information sharing.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And the second question, if I may, convener, is about the split as to complaints that you're handling in real time, as it were, as in they're live and happening to people right now and still happening to people, or after the fact. And I was reflecting before the committee started with the convener about the fact that, you know, on a number of occasions, myself and other colleagues, parliamentarians, have had to raise individual cases on the floor of Parliament and embarrass ministers and the First Minister to get action, and that action is actually then taken the next day. I don't think that's a particular way to run a health service, but it works at the moment for us. And I just wondered if you could give us an idea of what your office can do. So for example, in the case I'm talking about was a bed blocking case where a delayed discharge of 150 nights, a gentleman had been in a hospital after being declared fit and had got nowhere with the health board. What you could have done to help in that situation, and then speak to the split between real-time and after-the-fact complaints.
You've got to remember a couple of things here. One is that the Ombudsman is not a regulator. That's very important. And as Nikki said earlier on, the primary role of the Ombudsman is to deal with cases which require individual redress. The work that John Stevenson has done with the National Health Service to bring in the standardised complaints process should mean, and I say should mean, we'll see how it works, but should mean that complaints are defined earlier, investigated earlier, and concluded earlier. We should then allow things to come to the Ombudsman earlier. Because one of the things that frustrates my team in my office, you know, and at the moment I've got a lot of good people who get very frustrated from time to time, is that we see cases late. It takes a long time to come through the system before things get to us. So that should be there. But what we're not there to do is we're not there to do the job of the health board. We're not there to do the job of Healthcare Improvement Scotland. And at the moment, as I said earlier, we're precluded from looking at systemic issues. So you're a gentleman who had 150 nights in a bed. We could look at that, perhaps even while it was still happening, and come to a conclusion. But far better if the more appropriate management routes are working effectively. And just convene while I'm on my high horse, the one thing that my office is about is naming and learning, not naming and shaming. And I think one of the barriers to learning in the health service in Scotland has been the fear that people will be named and shamed, and the reputational damage that comes with, you know, publicity around failure, inverted commas, failure. And what I would hope the Parliament would move to, because I think we're a far more mature Parliament in many ways than our colleagues down south, is understanding that, yes, it's good to highlight when things have gone wrong, but the most important thing is to get the learning from that and ensure that things don't happen again. The vast majority of people who come to my office, the first thing they say is, I want to understand what happened here, and I want to make sure it didn't happen to anybody else ever again. So avoid, if you take advice, naming and shaming, it does not enhance learning.
Gets our guys out of hospital, though, sometimes.
Thank you, convener. On that note, I wanted to ask a little bit more about the Learning and Improvement Unit and whether there's a systematic approach to feeding in what you have, you know, the themes that you are getting from the complaints that you handle into the bigger governance picture, things like the near misses and the datex and things like that.
So I think that it's important to remember that previously the Ombudsman Service hasn't been resourced to undertake that wider kind of analysis work. This year we have secured funding, and going into the coming year we've secured funding to set up a very small unit of just three people to undertake some analysis work. As we've said before, we actually see a very small number of complaints proportionate to the whole of the health service. However, I think that there are opportunities to identify some thematic issues. So one of the things that this unit will do is publish themed reports across the whole of the public sector. So in March, we are actually publishing a report around informed consent and some of the issues that we've identified in relation to informed consent. And what we're looking for is areas where there is some space for us to add a voice and add some comment that is unique to what is already being said in that area. So, for example, another example might be an area like end-of-life care, where there is already a lot of research, investigation, guidance for that's produced by other bodies. And so I think we need to carefully think about how we use our resource so that we can genuinely add a unique voice and a unique picture to that area. Other pieces of work that I think that we're pursuing through that unit is, as we've said already, working with a small number of public bodies who bring high volumes of complaints where there are high uphold rates. And for me, that is very much around supporting organisations at that later investigation stage where things have become complex and intractable. I think that's where there's a skills gap and where organisations genuinely need support, education, guidance.
Thanks. I wonder if you could tell me a little bit about how you do feedback. So you feedback to health boards, do you, rather than to the place where the complaint originated from?
We arrive at a decision on an investigation. We report it in one of two ways. One way is that we'll issue a decision letter, which will go to the body, whether it be a board, a practice, a dentist, a pharmacist, whatever, and the person who has complained. And in that, there will be the decision, the reason for the decision, and recommendations for improvement. So that be shared. If we find a matter which is we regard as significant, either in the public interest or significant learning or whatever, we will issue that report individually as a separate report to Parliament. And we issued, I think, 38 health reports last year to Parliament. And these are significant cases where we see learning. Every month we will publish summaries of all of these decisions. So maybe 60 health complaints a month we will publish. We'll draw it to the attention of the board. NHS Scotland draws all their decisions to the attention of all the boards and where appropriate GP practices and others. And so by doing that, we're hoping to get learning from every decision we take into the system. As an ex-teacher, I'm not a very good teacher, but as an ex-teacher, I can tell you, you can have all the teaching materials in the world, but if you've got a bunch of kids in front of you who don't want to learn, you're struggling. And what I'm so, taken with over the work that John's done over the last couple of years is that the Scottish Health Council and the Health Service seem to be approaching this whole issue of complaints from the point of view of learning. Now, in order to get learning through, you have to create an environment and a culture which accepts that learning will come from when things go wrong. And to do that, you have to get to a position where when things go wrong, you don't just shoot people. So I think the whole thing is a continuum, and the work that Nikki's doing and the work that John's doing, I see meshing together to help the National Health Service to learn from the experiences that we see people having with their service.
Analytical work that you're doing, is there any... have you looked at identifying a correlation between complaints and, say, things like budget pressures or demographic change or socioeconomic factors? Have you done any of that work?
You've got to remember that this unit's been in existence for how many months?
Nine
months. Yeah, and we're looking across all of the sectors, and it's interesting that wherever we go and we talk about the Learning Improvement Unit, we have questions like, do you think you could maybe look at, the correlation between this and this and this and that? And I keep saying to people, we have three people. We got a budget for 1 year. It's been extended for another 1 year. We don't know if it's going to be there in year three. So we have to just cut our cloth in the first instance.
And I think, I know we've raised this point earlier as well, the data that the health service themselves will be required to publish on their own statistics. I think because the volumes that we see are small, I'm not sure how useful that analysis would be. I think the analysis has to be of the wider health service complaints data that this committee will have available to them. As Jim says, that's a fantastic opportunity for Scotland, that we will be the first country in Europe to be able to analyse this data across our public services, and it will be available.
Okay, Richard.
Good morning. Can I first of all say I wish you well in your retirement? Can we put this in context so that I've got, and we don't paint a bad picture about the health service? Correct me if I'm wrong. So you, for every health service complaint you get three about local government, correct?
No, we receive probably a couple of hundred more complaints a year about local authorities as we do about the health sector.
Right, okay. So every...
I'm sorry, it was across the NHS, we're looking at around about 20,000 complaints.
As against 62 for the...
As against 62. 60, but these are recorded by the sector, not cases that come to SPSO.
So that's the point I just want to clarify. Yeah. You said 21,000 for NHS and 62,000 for local government.
Yes.
Right. Every complaint is important, and I certainly agree with that. But taking on board that the National Health Service has, and this figure maybe... we'll get it checked out, has at least 1 million visits, appointments a year. Do you think the number of complaints that you get, which are all important, I agree, I've got one complaint with you already, sitting, yes, one. Unlike Mr. Cole Hamilton, I've only got one in just now. But basically, do you think that the number of complaints you get is proportionally high to the number of activities that take place in the health service? Your honest opinion.
I've had this put to me for the last 4 or 5 years. It's a kind of standard line. Yeah, I mean, we hear you, Jim, but there's 1 million contacts, you know, and local government say to me, we hear you, Jim, but there's millions of contacts and all the rest of that. And that's absolutely true. What I would be, if I was sitting where you were sitting just now, I'd be saying, okay, that's a given. The health service's own numbers, the ISD numbers that John was talking about, over the last 4 years, the increase in complaints, not to my office, but recorded by the ISD, over the last 4 years has gone up by 68%. Now, Mr. McKee was explaining earlier about his business experience, my business experience as well. If I was running a business and I saw complaints were going up at that rate, I'd be saying, well, maybe we better look at that. It is important to get it in proportion. This is not an indication that the National Health Service in Scotland is failing or it's on its last legs or anything like that. What I do think it does show you is that there are a number of cases, very, very serious cases, which is increasing, both in the National Health Service itself and to me. But worryingly, in the cases that are coming to me, I'm upholding more than half of the cases which health boards have not upheld. So if I were sitting on this committee, I'm not teaching my granny to suck eggs here, but were I sitting on this committee, I'd be saying, okay, if the Ombudsman is upholding half of the non-upheld cases that come to him, how many cases weren't upheld by health boards in Scotland? And what's the likely proportion of them where maybe the Ombudsman would come to a different conclusion if that came through? And that would then lead me to think, are we satisfied that even given the small proportion against the total number of contacts, that the investigation of complaints is thorough, robust, and at an acceptable level? And given the work that Robert Francis did on the Francis report and the risk there, where the chair's view was, we always see complaints, there's always lots of complaints, there's nothing you can do about complaints. Factoring all that in together, I would argue that, you know, it's not the only indicator the committee would have, but a very important indicator where the committee might be asking questions of the relevant people.
No, but there is something you can do about complaints. You can solve them before they're sent to you, and that's the reason why I asked you the question. Yeah. And that's the point, that in my experience, that if you look at what a problem someone has, and you sit down, and I've had that same discussion with my local health board, which is NHS Lanarkshire. Right. And basically, if you sit down, look at how people look at and go into the depth, and I agree with you, all too often I think they just go, no, you know, there's nothing we can do, and then the people come to us to put the complaints in. Anyway, I think I've flogged that enough. You made an interesting comment in your submission about the EU and Brexit. Sorry to bore people with that word again. Brexit. You say there's something which we're currently mindful of, but we're not clear what the impact may mean for the direct delivery of services, and we will be monitoring this carefully. Do you believe that if and when Britain, hopefully not Scotland, but Britain comes out of the EU, that laws will be changed which will affect your service in some way. You may want to expand on that.
Or not, convener.
Or not.
I think that the... I don't know what the Prime Minister's saying just now. I mean, she might be saying something that's of interest. I just don't know. I think as far as my office is concerned, the issues are, you know, what will the public service in Scotland look like post-Brexit? Is that likely to bring complaints to us? Until we find out what happens, we just don't know. But my successor, I'm sure, will be keeping an eye on this place and what committees like this think about Brexit and how that was going to impact on them.
One last small question, if you allow me. We're all talking about budgets. What is the cost of your service at this moment in time? Remind me. And because of the increase in the level of complaints you're getting right across the board, you know, you don't just deal with health, you deal with local government, you deal with other complaints. You know, are you coping or are you under pressure? Be honest.
£3.3 million. The budget I have is just over £3 million. Thank you for the opportunity to rant. I'll try and keep it short, convener. I have roughly the same number of people investigating complaints today as I had in 2009 when I came into the office. At that time in the office, we had cases sitting in my office which are 3 years old and older. We had, in fact, when I walked through the front door of my office, we had 92 cases which were over a year old and another significant number above 9 months old. We've turned that around. We took on prisons complaints, and at that point I went to see the presiding officer and said to the presiding officer, I think my office has enough capacity to deal with that without increasing our staff. And he said, well done, on you go. We then took on water complaints and we had the same conversations, and on you go. But over that period, the number of complaints I have come to my office has risen by about 40%. Productivity is up 31%. But when I go to the corporate body in the parliament and say, we now need more people, the answer is no. So I think parliament has to work out at some point what it's going to do with bodies like the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman and the Information Commissioner, who are effectively demand-led services financed by the parliament, who are funded as departments of the parliament. In other words, as if we were a finance department or an HR department with a fixed budget. And over the years, I've spoken to the chief executive and others about looking at different funding models. For example, you'll see in the material we've given you, we worked with NES to put together new training materials, which 19,000 plus people in the National Health Service have used. My argument was that we should license those training materials for use outside of Scotland, where they are being used for nothing. I suggested we should look at polluter pays systems, because at the moment the Scottish Parliament is funding the final tier of the complaints process for local government, health, prisons, etc. You're funding their budget. If we introduce polluter pays, that would then put a sense of responsibility onto the bodies concerned. I was very disappointed when I said in my strategic plan for the next 4 years that we should consider that the response from the chief executives and legal officers of local authorities was that one of the ways we should control demand was introducing a charge on people to access the ombudsman. Now, that will only hit the most vulnerable, and I don't think it's the way we do things in Scotland. So I think that when my successor comes in, I hope Parliament will say to him or her, what do you think you need to run this efficiently? Scrutinise that number, you know, play hardball with that number, but for goodness sake, listen to them. Because if we do not have the resource, all that happens is that ordinary people, families who are grieving very often, face inordinate delay in getting decisions which are of real importance to them. So, you know, parting shot as ombudsman, you know, going out the door, is for goodness sake, listen to my successor, and please, if you want an efficient ombudsman service, be prepared to fund it and resource it.
Thank you. I wish you well in your time.
Opportunity with aplomb, I must say, Claire. Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel. It's been really interesting hearing your answers to fellow committee members' questions. You very kindly there raised prison healthcare, which is what I was wanting to ask you about. From the information that you provided to us in your briefing, you say there's 137 complaints about prison healthcare in 2015-16, and you'll be aware that the committee is looking at conducting a short inquiry into prison healthcare. Could you tell me, does that figure cover the entirety of prison healthcare, so all of the services provided within there? And also, could you perhaps tell us what the most common complaints are that come from the prison healthcare service?
So yes, it does cover all of prison health complaints. I think it's fair to say I don't have the details with me, but the most common area of complaint is around prescription medication and whether or not things have been prescribed appropriately.
Sorry, it's just another hobby horse. Can I, if you indulge me for a minute? If the committee are looking at this, can I suggest an area that the committee might want to think about is how the ageing prison population is going to be catered for? I'm very, very concerned that as we have an ageing prison population, something in groups which are not the most popular, sex offenders in particular, people are getting older. All of the things that happen to people who are not in prison will happen to these prisoners. We will have more dementia, we'll have more mobility problems, you know, all the rest of it. If we are going to be humane in our treatment of prisoners, then there has to be a more close collaboration and strategic planning between the National Health Service and the Scottish Prison Service, particularly around areas like hospice care for people who are in prison. And I hope if the committee are looking at it, I'm really, really pleased that the committee are, that you test people's strategic thinking for how they're going to deal with this, what I think is a little time bomb.
Can I just follow up on the numbers for prison healthcare complaints? I think it's probably notable to say that as a percentage of all NHS complaints received in the last year, prison healthcare complaints have gone down. In terms of the complaints that come to SBSO, they've gone down slightly. And in terms of the numbers that we uphold, they've also gone down slightly. I think that working with NHS Tayside, for example, and NHS Lothian, I know there are some good initiatives going on in prison healthcare settings to try and resolve complaints quickly and early and at the point of contact. And it may be that some of that work is coming to fruition.
I was going to move on actually to that point, because the Ombudsman had provided some information previously to the committee saying that since the healthcare responsibility had been transferred to NHS from prison services, that there might actually be some barriers to prisoners making complaints. And I was going to ask what you've done in terms of making it easier for prisoners to access particularly your service when required.
I think in the early days of the transfer of responsibility from the Scottish Prison Service to the National Health Service in dealing with complaints from prisoners, there was a patchy response across the different health boards. Different health boards were interpreting the Scottish Government guidance on how to manage prisoner health complaints differently. And we had a lot of chats with the Scottish Government about what we were seeing, informally saying, look, we don't think things are working. And eventually, I think it was in the Ayrshire and Ireland Health Board that we saw an interpretation of what the complaint guidance letter from the Scottish Government meant, which we just couldn't match with what was happening elsewhere. And that led to discussions around what does it actually mean. For example, in one case I can think of, people were told in a prison that they couldn't make a complaint until they'd formally given feedback on a form, etc., because that's the way it was meant to be and that's the way the Scottish Government wanted it to be. Whereas in other health boards, this was not an issue. In some health boards, there were questions about whether the role of the Scottish Prison Service with prisoners, whether they were receiving healthcare advice and that kind of thing. I think that's largely been sorted out. I think we're now in a better place. And I see fewer things coming through which I think are systemic faults. You will see the occasional thing that goes wrong. I mean, that happens whether you're in prison or not. But in the early stages, I think it took a bit longer than it maybe should have to get over the teething problems. But I think we're largely over them now.
Okay. Any other questions? No. Thank you very much for your attendance this morning, and we wish you well when you
move on to Pastures New, and thank you very much for the evidence. We'll suspend briefly for the new panel. Thank you. The seventh item on the agenda is an evidence session with the Care Inspectorate. Can I welcome to the committee Karen Reid, Chief Executive, and Paul Eddy, Chair, both of the Care Inspectorate. Can I invite Karen to make her an opening statement?
It's Paul that's going to do that, Paul. Convener. Thank you.
This morning. Care Inspectorate Chair are the scrutiny body that supports improvement and is responsible for inspecting and reporting the quality of care that older people experience. And we were formed in 2011 with the merger of the Old Care Commission and the Old Social Work Inspection Agency, with some duties transferred across from Education Scotland at that time. We, as well as inspecting and reporting on the quality of care, we also highlight good care, and we work closely with care providers to support them to improve, to help them improve. And when they're not prepared to do that, we do have, and their quality of care isn't good, we do have extensive enforcement powers. We also work with providers wherever possible to support innovation within health and social care delivery. And we regulate and inspect across a broad range of services. Around 14,000 services are registered with us annually. And almost 9,500 of those are services for children and young people. We work collaboratively with a range of other partners, including Education Scotland, Healthcare Improvement Scotland, Audit Scotland, the Police and the Prisons Inspectorates, and the SSSC and NHS Education, amongst others. We carry out joint inspections to see how well organised in local areas services work together to protect people and to make a positive difference in people's lives. And joint inspections, for example, of children's services, everywhere in Scotland we carry these out, and they bring together professional inspectors from care, from social work, from health, police and education. And similarly, we work with Healthcare Improvement Scotland to jointly inspect the effectiveness of collaborative working between health, social work and social care services for older people and their carers. We also have a role in providing independent scrutiny of criminal justice social work across Scotland, and we're developing a positive working relationship with Community Justice Scotland as the new model of community justice is being implemented. Almost everyone of us will use a care service at some point in our lives, and we believe as a body that every person should receive high quality, safe and compassionate care that meets their rights, choices and needs. We're also changing the way that we work. We're building on our experience close working relationships with other scrutiny partners to deliver new models, new methodologies to focus on new statutory duties around integration and strategic commissioning. And we're embarking on a transformation plan of our own organisation. And over the next couple of years, our priorities include consolidating excellence, changing our internal culture, building a competent, confident workforce, and collaborating with external scrutiny and care delivery partners and people who experience care, their families and their carers. We're also seeking to move from a traditional compliance-based approach to a more collaborative approach, away from a regulatory perspective to a more modern scrutiny approach, one which acts as a diagnostic on which to provide assurance and also to target improvement. Critical to all of this, I think, is going to be the new national care standards. They're going to be crucial in the way that care and scrutiny are delivered. Currently, these are out for consultation, and although they're government standards, the Care Inspectorate and Healthcare Improvement Scotland, have coordinated their development, and they've been created in partnership with people who use care themselves, which I think is to be welcomed. Once these are completed, I think they're going to be the most radical standards anywhere in Europe, perhaps further afield, and they'll have the potential to really transform how care is planned and delivered. They'll apply across all settings, including how services are commissioned by integrated joint boards. And it's very much a move away from the traditional approach of minimal or technical inputs and more of a focus on outcomes and a person's experience of care. So with that, Chair, we're happy to take questions.
Okay, thank you very much. Alex.
Vina, good morning. Thank you for coming to see us today. I have two questions. Firstly, it's about self-directed support. Obviously, this is something of an undiscovered country that we are still moving into. The uptake has not been as great, I think, as people perhaps expected at first, but it is still happening. And with self-directed support, obviously, comes a great deal of very welcome choice and flexibility in the delivery of care to service users, and that is in many cases directed by themselves. How has the Care Inspectorate found the implementation of SDS, particularly in the way that the market has responded for things like care at home services, how you regulate care and inspect care at home services, and indeed a broader range of providers than perhaps existed before SDS came in?
Okay, thank you. I'll take that question. What we have found, we've undertaken 13 joint inspections of health and social care partnerships to date, and what we found is, as you say, quite a variable picture in terms of the uptake of SDAs. In relation to the care inspectorate's position, we actively support people making informed choice and decisions about their care, and in particular ensuring that the care that they experience meets their needs, rights and choices. One of the things that we are quite well aware of, given the variable picture that we've seen from the 13 joint inspections that we've undertaken in terms of the implementation of SDAs, is that we actually require to do more work. So during this 17-18, it's our intention to actually commence scoping a thematic review of self-directed support, and I would welcome the opportunity to report back to this committee in terms of our findings.
Thank you. The second question is relating to your work with other organisations. You touched on that briefly, Paul. When I was first elected, one of the first cases I took up with was the campaign of a constituent I have in a care home who had been very badly burned in a bath in a different care home. And that was not necessarily... It was partly a failure of the care that she was receiving, but also a mechanical failure as well. And I just wondered what your kind of links with the health and safety executive were, and how that read across, and who holds responsibility for learning in cases like that.
And I do recall the case I think I responded to you on, the specific incident, which was tragic. The first and foremost thing to say is that we expect every care provider to deliver safe, compassionate and high quality care. Where that doesn't happen, we work with a range of bodies, the Health and Safety Executive being one, and in that specific instance, we did work with the Health and Safety Executive in terms of looking at the details of the case. What tends to happen is where there's a predominant focus on the quality of care, then the Care Inspectorate would be the lead agency in terms of looking at any investigation around about that, but we do of course bring in specialist support wherever we require that in relation to health and safety, or it could be in relation to health, for example. So that's how we tend to work. I think what's critical in terms of what you described though is the learning that came out of that incident. So one of the things that's very different about the Care Inspectorate, and indeed a new responsibility that the organisation had in its inception in 2011, is a statutory responsibility to support improvement. So in relation to those types of incidents that you're describing, what we would do on the back of that is actually work with the provider to say, what's the learning from this, and actually tell us how you're supporting improvement and making sure that the changes that need to happen to ensure that people enjoy good quality care across Scotland are actually in place.
I wonder, it might be helpful, certainly be helpful for me, if you could maybe describe the kind of process you go through where... on doing an inspection. So, for example, I'm sorry that we often dwell on negatives in order to exemplify our points, but it's often the experience that we have with people coming to us. But I certainly was heavily involved in the issue around the Pentland Hills care home, which was a catalogue of failure, ultimately ending in the closure of the care home. I'm really... wondering how we got to a situation where the police were involved, there was deaths, when the dogs in the street knew that there was serious problems within that establishment, and yet it took an age for to get to the position where that was closed down. So sorry to give you a negative example, but it's just to understand how it took such a long period of time. And also, maybe in a more positive frame, if you could describe the process you go through in terms of your inspections, and at what point do you involve different agencies, the person who runs the establishment, all of that kind of thing.
Thank you for that. And I welcome your focus on the fact that sometimes it's the negative areas that we dwell on, because what we see across Scotland, by and large, is really high quality care. So I would like to give that assurance to the committee. But going back to the particular issue that you're raising in terms of how we undertake our inspection, we've moved away, as Paul mentioned earlier, we've moved away from a position of quite a traditional approach to regulation where we focus on inputs, to one over the last couple of years that we're actually looking at much more around collaboration to support improvement. So scrutiny in itself is a diagnostic that actually helps us use our intelligence to really delve in and find out what's working well and what needs to improve. We have a range of mechanisms that enable us to form a picture of what's happening within a care service, for example. We have notifications that come in to us, so care service providers must tell us about particular incidents that happen within a care home or a care setting. We also get a lot of information through our complaints process, and rather uniquely, we are an organisation that has a statute responsibility to investigate complaints, so complaints can be made to us by an individual or indeed anonymously, and I know that some of you around the table today have also been in touch with me to raise concerns and make complaints. So we take all of that intelligence. We also look at what we've got in terms of our own intelligence from our scrutiny activities, and we use that to actually, as a diagnostic, to help us hone in on where some of the concerns are lying. So one of the things that particularly helps us in terms of the intelligence that we receive, so the care inspectorate may be in a service once every 12 months, for example, in a care home. There are many health professionals and social care professionals in and out. Families are in and out a care service as well. So we really welcome some of the intelligence that we get from, for example, district nurses. And I think in the case of Pentland Hills, we did receive information from nursing profession to enable us to be much more detailed in our scrutiny activities and therefore find out truly what's going on within a service and what the quality of care. Going back to the point that you made around the time taken to actually close the service, what we must always remember when someone moves into residential care, for example, it becomes someone's own home. And therefore, none of us in this room would like to have to move every time a care setting was closed. But equally so, what's critically important is that we have enforcement powers, and we use those, and we use those wisely. So where there is a risk to life, health or safety of any resident, then of course we're going to use those powers. But at every opportunity, and unlike the organisation down south that is our sister organisation, we support improvement at every single turn if that's possible and it doesn't impact on the health, safety and well-being of vulnerable people. In relation to the particular example, one of the things that we do is we can issue requirements, we can issue improvement notices, and we try to work with service providers and have ongoing dialogue throughout our whole scrutiny process. There are no surprises here. No provider should be surprised by the outcome of a scrutiny activity, whether that's an inspection or a complaints investigation, because we will be sharing with them and asking questions about our findings and our observations of practice all the way through that process. We can apply to the sheriff, and this is sometimes where delays set in, that in terms of the evidence base and the high tests are required to close a service, we have to apply to a sheriff to enable us to do that. The other thing that I'd like to share with the committee this morning is not only do we have a responsibility in terms of providing public assurance, and that's done through our scrutiny activities, we have a responsibility to support improvement, but under the regulator's code, we've also got a responsibility in terms of sustaining economic growth and indeed community empowerment. So all of these fit together, and we need to think of that in terms of how we best support vulnerable people in Scotland, first and foremost, to remain in their own homes and receive high quality care.
There have been other cases where, and very few, I hasten to add, but where an inspection has been carried out and they've been given a good report or a, you know, satisfactory report, only for pretty soon afterwards some horrendous practices exposed in that establishment. How does that happen?
It's a really important question. I actually welcome it. The care inspectorate can be in services 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. When we go in and undertake scrutiny, we're evidencing what our findings are based on the intelligence process that I've just explained. However, things can escalate very quickly within a care setting. So, for example, where we see a change of manager, where we see agency staff coming in, all of these can compound what is actually a very good service, can then change very quickly overnight and issues escalate. If you've got a member of staff who's not sure about how to actually best support an individual, if you've got agency staff coming in who don't know the needs and choices and wishes of an individual, then that can escalate very quickly. And that's sometimes, not always, but sometimes where we see some of the issues, convener, that you're describing this morning.
Okay, thank you, Richard.
Convener, can I turn to a similar vein that I asked in the last panel? The number of complaints you're getting, I believe 2,000 complaints, the majority of which were upheld. upheld. Are you concerned about the number of complaints you're getting? And I have to also, again, put on the record that I believe that every complaint is important, and every, you know, the number of care homes you're, or care services you're looking at, 13,678. Number of care homes you look after, 1,430. What is the majority of the complaints you're getting? Is it care services, or is it care homes, or is it a mixture of both?
The majority of complaints that we receive are actually about care homes and generally care homes for older people. You're quite right that in the past year we received 4,086 complaints and we investigated around half of those. In terms of the complaints that we see, we've seen a 46% rise since 2011 when the care inspector was established. What I would say is treat that figure with caution, because we've undertaken significant public awareness raising about the complaints process and encourage people to access that. At every opportunity, we would encourage people to try to resolve their complaint with the service provider, but we also recognise that sometimes that's not possible. And that's one of the reasons why people can come to us to make a complaint. They can make that complaint in person, or indeed they can make that complaint anonymously. In terms of the complaints about care homes, what we tend to see is around 25% of the complaints about care homes for older people focus in on specific healthcare, and that tends to be around nutrition, medication, infection prevention control, that type of thing. We also see some complaints around staffing, which is around 16% of the complaints we receive, and indeed communication plays a big part, around 10.7% of the complaints that we receive. In relation to care homes, we tend to uphold about 75% of the complaints that we receive.
Thank you, Convener. That's all.
Alison?
You spoke earlier about enforcement powers and said that you can apply to a sheriff. I just wondered if that's a timely process, when you have to do that, and also how often are you using enforcement powers?
We have served just over 30 enforcement notices on 21 services over the course of the last year. What we tend to do is we focus on improvement first and foremost. And the reason for that is that wherever we can support a provider to improve a service, that means that people stay in their own home. And what we're looking for is the quality of care and their experience and outcomes to improve. So we always try to support improvement first and foremost. Firstly, because of the benefits it brings to people residing in a service, but actually there are economic benefits in terms of, and perhaps, Convener, with your permission, I might digress slightly and just to illustrate my point. Day in, day out, our inspectors work with care services across Scotland, one, to undertake inspection, but also to support improvement. We had an example, and this is one of many, many examples, as I say, day in, day out. We had an example of a care home in the northeast of Scotland in quite a deprived area, where around 20 residents, very vulnerable, high dependency needs, were looking at actually having to move out of the care service because the care service had bumped along for a short period of time. We were not happy in terms of their ability to improve. We had two choices. We could apply to a sheriff in terms of closure of the service, or we could bring in and work with the local authority, the local health liaison coordinator. We also have, quite uniquely as well, a health and improvement wellbeing team in the care inspectorate with a range of professional knowledge around, for example, pharmacy, tissue viability, rehabilitation, dementia, and so on. We brought in a team to work with the service. Over a period of time, a short period of time, the service made significant improvements. The net result of that was that they have sustained those improvements, I may add. 20 people remained in their own home, but actually people living in quite a deprived community in Scotland retained their jobs, and suppliers continued to supply the care service. So that's not just a one-off example. Our staff in the care inspectorate do that day in, day out.
Well, I suppose you're in a very good position to study, if you like, any pressures arising in the care service because of, you know, the move to make sure that people aren't in hospital, aren't in acute services. Do you see that that growth in numbers is increasing pressure on the services? And is that increased pressure impacting on quality at all?
having the benefit of being a scrutiny body that looks at both the national picture in terms of strategic scrutiny and indeed regulated care service scrutiny means that we can draw some of the conclusions that I think you're referring to. We work very closely with Healthcare Improvement Scotland in relation to adults and older people, and indeed Education Scotland in relation to children's services, to look at a strategic level in terms of some of the outcomes, the strategic commissioning that's happening across either the Integrated Joint Board or indeed the Community Planning Partnership. That enables us to look at what we're actually seeing in terms of some of those pressures, but equally so, how are those pressures, if they are translating into a much more local level and therefore impacting on the experiences and outcomes of individuals. So it's a really precious and invaluable golden thread in terms of having that robust scrutiny and assurance regime, both at a national and at a local level.
Can I ask another question, Convener? It seems that there are more complaints about care homes than there are, you know, for those who are being looked after at home. Why do you think that is? Is that a cultural problem? Is it about education? Is it about engagement with yourself and making sure that improvement happens?
It's a mix of all of those things. And one of the things that tends to happen is that when you make that really, really difficult choice to place your loved one within a residential care setting, you're going in, you're visiting, you're looking at what's happening, you're hearing what's happening to your loved one, then you're much more familiar in terms of, is this right? Is this the quality of care I want for my loved one? And therefore accessing the complaints process perhaps more quickly than what happens out with that.
Peter, can I ask one final question, please? Personal assistants aren't covered by the regulatory regime. Why is that the case, and is it at all problematic?
I'm not able to answer why personal assistants are not covered. It's certainly not covered by the legislation. Does it pose risks? Then yes, of course it does. But, and this is really crucial for the committee to hear, there is still a responsibility in terms of strategic commissioning, or the commissioning of local authorities in particular in terms of the use of personal assistance. We would expect every local authority to undertake the necessary checks and balances before they actually arranged for example, direct payment in relation to personal assistance. So I know that people are concerned about risk, and rightly so, but it's crucially important that we remember that actually there are checks and balances there in relation to the local authority. And perhaps if I may just digress slightly, because this is critically important, we recognise some of those risks, and whilst we don't have a statutory responsibility to look at personal assistance, what we do have is a statutory responsibility to look at adult support and protection. Adult support and protection has not traditionally had the same focus in terms across Scotland as child protection. And one of the things we will be doing next year, along with the thematic review of SDS, and it's by no means a coincidence that we're doing this, is we will be looking at adult support and protection. And again, I'd welcome the opportunity to come back to this committee in due course with the evidence that we find in relation to a national overview of adult support and protection. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, can I just ask about a number of things relating to your relationship with Healthcare Improvement Scotland. In the previous session with the Ombudsman, we heard about a uniform complaint system across health and social care, which in the age of integration, I think we can all see the sense of. And I think in the papers, it's clear that yourselves and Healthcare Improvement Scotland work together and that there are new joint statutory arrangements about commissioning, etc. You'd accept, though, I think, that they're very different bodies, yourself and Healthcare Improvement Scotland. One's a non-territorial health board, and yourselves are independent, non-departmental. And my general question is, do you have any observations about the continuing operation of these two distinct regulatory bodies within the world of integration?
I do, actually. Thank you. And I've been asked this question a number of times of late. What I would say to that is, it's really important that we consider the totality of both organisations' roles and responsibilities. You're absolutely right that we have very different and very broad remits. And from the Care Inspectorate's perspective, in addition to that very small and shared interface with Healthcare Improvement Scotland around strategic commissioning and indeed improvement, we also have responsibility, as Paul mentioned in his opening statement, for social work services, 9,500 children's services. We have lead agency responsibility for joint inspection of services for children, child protection, adult protection, multi-agency public protection arrangements, community justice, significant case reviews, serious incident reviews, and deaths of looked after children. So I hope that what that sets out for you is that in terms of our range of statutory responsibilities, including a statutory responsibility to support improvement across the whole of the social care sector, it's quite significant. One of the pieces of work that we have done with Healthcare Improvement Scotland recently, and I'm certainly very happy, Convener, with your agreement to send this in for your information, is we've mapped out the differing roles and responsibilities of both bodies and where we have a small interface and how we actually add public value. And that's the critical question, is whether our relationship is with Healthcare Improvement Scotland or whether it's with Education Scotland, the key question is how do these organisations come together to add public value and therefore ensure that the quality of care, learning, justice is actually what we would want to see across Scotland. So I hope that answers your question.
Can I maybe just add to that? Because I sit on the board of HIS as well, and Denise Coya sits on our board as well. And you have to remember, I mean, we employ a lot of inspectors and we carry out thousands of inspections. With HIS, they have things like SIGN, the medical devices body, the Medicines Consortium, the Health Council. There's a very wide variety of activities that aren't registration and inspection. And as Karen said, the interface is important, but it is actually quite small. They employ a handful of inspectors in comparison to us.
Just on about providing the committee with more information, one of the things the Ombudsman provided us was an analysis of complaints about the sectors. It was very obvious he was talking about health, but you have subsectors, if you like, subsections of what you look at. Could you provide us with that and what those complaints are about? So is it workforce issues, is it communications or whatever?
Absolutely. We've very recently just produced our five-year report on our findings around complaints. I'll ensure that that comes to you, Convener.
Hey, Alex.
Just a couple more questions. Firstly, and I should declare an interest here in that before I came to this place, I worked for 8 years for a social care provider, Abelara Childcare Trust. Exemplary work that they do there. But I'd like to ask about context, because I think knowing the social care environment, particularly some of the higher sort of tariff needs end of the spectrum in terms of care home provision, social care can be quite a visceral place, environment, and quite a frenetic one as well. And I just wonder, you know, where context comes in. For example, you know, if there's a pattern of injuries coming out of a care home due to passive restraint because of the very severe behavioural needs of the people within that. How does the balance work? And is there sufficient expertise within your inspectors to understand the nature of the care that they're inspecting?
Yes, and what I would say is that just a couple of years ago, we changed the way that we actually undertook our inspection activities, and we will be changing our methodology in coming months as well. Our inspectors now focus on their area of specialism. So previously they had generic caseloads, now they have specialism. So only those with an adult background would be inspecting adult services, only those with a children's background would be inspecting children's services. And that really plays to the professional knowledge and skill that our inspectors bring. In relation to issues around restraint, it's actually quite an interesting one. We're a member of the National Preventative Mechanism, which is a UK-wide body. Where we see issues around restraint, we will regularly work with organisations such as the Mental Welfare Commission, where we believe that our intelligence tells us there may well be some issues around restraint. So we reach out and get specialist expertise, and I think I mentioned that earlier in relation to your point about the Health and Safety Executive. Similarly, if there are issues about restraint that we are concerned about, we will reach out for specialist expertise. But by and large, I am absolutely confident that the inspectors working with the care inspectorate have the knowledge and expertise to conduct and fulfil our statutory responsibilities effectively.
Well, that's very good to hear. And the second one speaks to your point that you made about your role in terms of the death of looked after children. Again, part of my work with Abelara was influencing the passage of the Children and Young People Bill, and the big battle that we've sort of faced with legislators, with all stakeholders really, was an understanding that our responsibilities to look after children does not end with the removal of their supervision order, but actually they become care experienced young people, and we still have a duty of care to them. And the fact that before that bill passed, there was no knowledge about life outcomes really for care leavers. There was no sort of mechanism for when a care leaver died prematurely, although they are demonstrably far more likely to die prematurely than somebody who's not been in care. That finally we got a provision within the bill that ministers, Scottish ministers, will be informed on the death of a care leaver. What role will your organisation play in helping to deliver on that responsibility, but secondly to disseminate learning and investigative work around that?
Okay, thank you. So we have a statutory responsibility when we are notified of the death of a looked after child, we have a responsibility to actually look into what's actually happened and what are the learning from the situation. Every death of a looked after child is a tragic situation. What we want to see on the back of that is taking the learning from our review of a death of a looked after child and see the partners involved, so primarily local authorities but other partners as well, take some of that learning and think about how could we make this better for looked after young people in the future. So we take all of that in terms of the learning from our review, we put it into practice in terms of improvement. We also have a link inspector who undertakes a role working very closely with, at the moment, local authorities, but very soon to be across the integrated joint boards. We would expect our link inspectors to be having conversations with those local authorities if there has been a death of a looked after child and actually supporting them around some of the improvements that they need to make. And that's actually the real added public value of having an organisation that can undertake both the scrutiny element but also support improvement, quite unique to what's happening down south.
Okay, and if I may just tease out one of the points in your answer there, Karen, thank you for that. In terms of the looked after children population, as is in Scotland, on any given day we have 15,000 children in care. The majority of those children are actually looked after at home. I'm not really familiar, because Abelard didn't deliver services for looked after children at home, what are the sort of powers and responsibilities that you have to have some sort of oversight of those children, because I would imagine, given that their life outcomes are demonstrably worse than any other looked after cohort, that there's probably a higher ratio of deaths in that cohort as well. And so as such, can you speak to your responsibility to look after children at home?
And I'm very happy to follow up with a subsequent conversation with yourself if that would be useful. Yeah. One of the things that we do in terms of our joint inspection of services for children, we have a responsibility as part of that process to look at outcomes in particular for looked after children, whether they're looked after at home or away from home. So we utilise our responsibilities and discharge them through that process. We actually report, and again, I'd be happy to share this with the convener, we have an update report of our first 2 years of joint inspections and some of the findings. Some of the critical issues we find around looked after children in particular, but actually in terms of child protection, those children who are on the child protection register, is the local authorities' responsibilities in terms of undertaking appropriate assessment. Chronologies is a big issue, the ability to respond to immediate concerns and need. So as well as being able to identify where those hotspots are and what needs to improve in terms of delivering better outcomes for children and young people in Scotland, we've also got a responsibility to help support improvement in relation to our link inspector role, working more closely with local authorities to ensure that they are actually learning and sharing that learning. The other thing that I would add for committee members' information is we have a hub, so you can go online to the Care Inspectorate website. We have a hub that's got a range of good practice that we see during our scrutiny activities that we actually promulgate on our website. So I would actively encourage, if you've got a particular area of interest, then to go onto our website and access some of the good practice that we see across the country.
Claire.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel, for your answers so far. I'd just like to expand a little bit on what Alex Cole-Hamilton was talking about there about learning from experience that you've had and from the reports that you've done. We heard the Ombudsman earlier on referring to the Francis report, which one of the major criticisms there was no corporate memory in the NHS in England at that point in time. And I'd be keen to hear about how you disseminate some of the learning that you have from inspections that you do, good and bad experience, particularly to, you were talking about nursing home sector, where there are a high level of complaints. Often they work in small businesses, isolated, perhaps not as plugged into bigger support networks as perhaps the NHS is. And so if you could maybe expand a little bit on how you make sure that you disseminate the your findings to those areas.
Thank you. Every single inspection that we undertake results in a public report, and that's available on our website. So we would also expect providers to be able to share our reports with people who experience care or their families or carers. So we produce around, this past year, 7,400 inspection reports at regulated care service level. They're all available on our website. In terms of some of the learning, as I said earlier, scrutiny is not a compliance-based process. It's not where we were probably 5 years ago. It's a process about working with a provider to actually identify what's working well, where there is good practice, and highlighting that good practice, but equally so, working with a provider to support improvement. So our inspectors, although scrutiny happens across a short period of time, we would expect to see that ongoing dialogue, no surprises about our findings, and support for improvement at the end of the scrutiny intervention. So in terms of overall, we, I think at the last count, did around 12 to 14,000 scrutiny and improvement interventions. Of those, about 7,400 were actual inspections. So you can see from those figures that there's quite a significant focus on supporting improvement. The other thing that I would say is that where we see things working really well and really good examples of practice, once we've undertaken two inspections, we will highlight good practice out in the media. But similarly, where we're seeing poor practice, not only will we take immediate action in terms of trying to support improvement or indeed moving forward with enforcement, we also put that information out in the press as well. So two episodes of good, two episodes of really poor, and it goes out into the public domain. Equally so, over the course of the last 18 months or so, we've developed a really powerful and strong relationship with Scottish Care, which, given the majority of care home providers in Scotland are from the private sector, we work very closely with Scottish Care in terms of supporting improvement and are doing some close pieces of work ensuring that care home providers across the country can actually deliver high quality care. Thank you.
We also picked up our engagement with service providers through quality conversations. So some of the running issues are teased out at those, and it allows us to take soundings from the various sectors as well as give them some of our thinking and keep them in the loop. Also, we've had some quite successful conferences as well. Maybe do you want to maybe tell us a little bit about the continence conference we had?
Yes, absolutely. We were very grateful to the Chief Nursing Officer who provided part funding for us to undertake a conference that actually supported the development of a continence resource, particular but not exclusively for people with dementia. So the conference attracted over 350 delegates, and we actually had a waiting list as well. So there's a whole range of different things that we can do in terms of sharing information, promoting our findings, having quality conversations with providers, and we tend to do that by sector type to actually find out what are the issues, how can we work more collaboratively with you, because ultimately we've all got the same end goal in mind. We all want people in Scotland to experience high quality, safe and compassionate care, and taking a compliance, a stick-based approach doesn't enable that to happen. So working much more collaboratively, sharing information, highlighting good practice is undoubtedly the way to go. Thank you.
I think earlier you said that 75% of complaints were upheld, is that correct? In relation to care homes, have they gone through that particular organisation's complaints procedure before they come to you?
I don't have that information to hand, but I can certainly check and come back to you, Convener.
Because I think the committee, reading the committee in the earlier session, was quite surprised that 56% of complaints were upheld within Jim Martin's remit, and in yours it's 75%. Does that cause you a lot?
75% care homes.
Yes,
I think it's 67%, yeah. Is it?
Well, it's 59% universally across care services. So
both of them are quite big
absolutely.
Figures. Do they cause you concern and alarm?
They do, and what I would say to that is, first and foremost, wherever we see a complaint, we investigate a complaint. We don't just leave it at publishing our investigative results. We actually work with the care provider in terms of supporting improvement. So it doesn't just stop with undertaking a complaints investigation. What we want to see is the follow-through in terms of how do you support improvement within a care setting, because ultimately that leads to better outcomes and experiences for individuals. So that tends to be our focus now, rather than purely stopping and drawing a line once the complaint investigation is undertaken. And I hope that gives some assurance, although the statistics may sound alarming in terms of 75% of all those complaints about care homes for older people being upheld, we do follow through in the back of that and ensure that we work with providers to support them to improve, regardless of what area they may need to improve in, whether that's in health and bringing in our health and improvement wellbeing team or in other areas.
And have you done any analysis of the source or trends within that? So, for example, we hear the care home providers say that they are really under pressure financially. Is that an issue?
We're not seeing that in terms of some of the complaints that we're investigating. What we have done is we've analysed the source of where the complaints are coming from, and they do tend to come from family members or indeed staff who work in the social care sector. And some time ago, about a year ago, we actually put out a public awareness campaign and requested that social and healthcare professionals actually have a responsibility where they are entering into a care setting and they are not seeing good quality care. Actually, it's their professional responsibility to highlight those both to the care service provider, but actually they can come to the care inspectorate to investigate complaints about the quality of care and care services. The briefing that I said I would send in, convener, in terms of the five-year overview, gives a whole range of distilled information about our complaints, both in terms of where they came from, the types of complaints we receive, where they're upheld across all different types of care settings, and so on. So I'm sure that information will be particularly helpful to you. And again, I'm very happy to have a further conversation, either in the context of Parliament or indeed with you individually, if that's useful.
Two things in relation to the workforce. I think it's a good thing that they're approaching yourselves, but is that an indication of a problem within the organisation, the owners of the organisation, and that staff maybe don't feel confident in approaching them about a particular issue?
Not always. So, you know, there are pockets of that, there's no doubt about it. But it could be, for example, a nurse who is accessing a care home that's concerned about the quality of care, that raises it with the care home manager, but actually also comes to the care inspectorate as well. So it's not an either or, and there's a mixed, you know. No, not at all. We would always encourage people to try and resolve complaints at the earliest opportunity and with the care service provider, if at all possible. But sometimes it's not possible to do that, and we recognise that. So that's one of the reasons why we take complaints, whether or not they've been through the actual care service provider's process, and indeed anonymously.
One final thing from me. We have heard, and we took evidence from social care staff about a whole range of workforce issues in relation to their employment. And we've heard that you raised yourself issues about agency staff, and obviously the implication of that is about continuity of care. One of the first things that the social care staff raised with us was about their concern about continuity of care. But on top of that, we've got a whole range of other workforce issues around low pay, the lack of value that they see as society placing on their work, insecure contracts, all of that. Do you believe that these issues are contributing to people's feelings that the social care system is not as good as it could be?
I think first thing to say,
do you think that we treat our social care staff fairly and value them enough?
Okay, thank you. The first thing to say, and to set in context, we see over 85% of care services in Scotland with evaluations, that's professional evaluations, of good, very good or excellent. So that's quite significant in terms of the quality of care that's happening. As you said, convener, the things that tend to cause us the most concern is the really negative things that we find out about. Overall, the majority of care services in Scotland, we actually evaluate the quality of staffing. So we look at practice, we look at qualifications, we look at training, and we're finding that the majority of care services across Scotland are actually getting good, very good, or excellent evaluations. That said, we know there is an issue in terms of the use of agency staff. We know there is an issue in terms of temporary contracts. Those in themselves are not specific issues for the care inspectorate, but where they impact on the quality of care, they are. What we're actually seeing, and we've got a real opportunity at the moment in terms of integrated health and social care, is to look at integration in action. And what I mean by that is we've got a real opportunity, for example, in the private care home sector to work more closely with NHS in terms of nursing staff. We have got an opportunity in terms of looking at recruitment and retention. So we've recently worked with the Scottish Social Services Council, which is the professional regulator, as you know, for the social care workforce, to produce safer recruitment guidance. And that means that not only are we looking at the recruitment process, we're looking at the values and qualities that staff members bring in to social care in terms of being able to deliver not just the clinical side of care, but actually the value side of care, being able to be compassionate, nurturing, and much more in line with the new national care standards that are out for consultation at the moment.
But around these workforce issues, around pay and conditions, do you think we treat staff fairly in that regard?
I think without a doubt the progress made in terms of implementation of the living wage is great. What we are looking at, and it's too early for us to tell, given, and you'll bear in mind that we do a respective look over the last 12 months in terms of the quality of care, we're not seeing implications of the living wage at this moment in time, but rest assured we are looking to see if we're seeing implications from the living wage in terms of the quality of care. So we are pleased to see the living wage being implemented. We want to see, is there any impact in terms of the sustainability and therefore the quality of care as a result of that?
I'm not sure if that was a yes or a no to my question. Miles.
Point, kind of leading on from the question you just outlined there, Convener, it's with regards to visit times, and I think that's what raised with me again and again by constituents, is this 10-15 minute visit times, which many people who are being cared for at home receive, just not being enough time, and some really concerning issues around that with hearing aids being lost and people being left without their hearing aids fitted properly. Do you actually think that period of time is enough? And if it's not, in your eyes, what do you think the government and local authorities should be doing to broaden that, to improve care in Scotland?
I think it's very difficult to say, is it enough or isn't it enough? Because when one, you know, thinks about 10, 15 minutes, is that adequate time? Then it, without actually knowing the context of what someone's actually looking at. So for example, if it's primarily a visit to ensure someone's taking medication, then perhaps that is enough time. If it's about the quality of care and looking at personal care or various things in terms of an individual's needs, rights and choices, then it will depend. So it's not easy for me to answer that without having a context, but I know that it is a particular issue. What I would say is that where we are seeing hearing aids being lost, people not being treated particularly well, where we see the quality of care in terms of some of the care at home and housing support services, then of course we will take immediate action. Or indeed, we would actively encourage you to encourage people in your constituency to lodge a complaint with the care inspectorate.
Colin.
Thanks very much, Convener. In your written submission, you note the fact that you report publicly on emerging themes and trends in relation to the quality of care. Can I ask whether or not you are concerned about or aware of problems in care services resulting, for example, from extra pressures on obviously increasingly limited resources, and does that impact on either the number of enforcement actions you've taken or learning experiences you've recommended?
Okay. 5 years ago, the care inspectorate, when the care inspectorate was established, the quality of care was probably around 80%, and we're actually seeing an improvement in terms of the quality of care overall in Scotland. That comes at a time where we recognise some of the challenges that are happening in the social care sector. But with those challenges also comes opportunities in terms of innovation. One of the things that we're currently looking at, for example, is some of the pressing funding constraints that are happening across Scotland means that service providers are looking at different models of care. So one of the things we're supporting at the moment is working with a large national care provider around the Birdsong model and different ways of designing, delivering and commissioning care. So we recognise that there are financial challenges. We recognise that both at a strategic level in terms of our responsibility in strategic commissioning, and as I mentioned earlier, the golden thread that runs through between strategic commissioning and what we're seeing in terms of outcomes and experiences of care at a regulated care service puts us in a really robust position as a scrutiny and improvement body. So to summarise, yes, there are some challenges about funding. Yes, there are opportunities in terms of improvement and innovation. We are watching the impact of the living wage very carefully, and we're also supporting care service providers to think differently about the models of care that they are designing and developing. The care that we are all familiar with today will be significantly different, I've no doubt, in the next 3 to 5 years in terms of the way that it's designed, delivered and commissioned. And the care inspectorate is absolutely front and central to empowering and enabling that to happen.
Yeah, I take on board what you say, but it doesn't really answer the specific question of whether or not, when you look at, as you say in your written submission, emerging themes, whether or not the pressure on resources is an emerging theme, and whether or not that impacts on, for example, the number of enforcement actions you take or the number of learning experiences you recommend.
Apologies, I should have answered your point about enforcement action. No, we're not seeing a year-on-year increase in relation to the enforcement actions that we undertake. And that's primarily because over the last couple of years, the care inspectorate has moved away from that traditional compliance-based approach to one that's about supporting improvement. So every opportunity, we will try to work with a provider to improve. In terms of some of those financial challenges and constraints that you mention, because of that work in terms of supporting improvement, we're not actually seeing that in terms of impacting on the quality of care. But we're not naive, and rest assured, when we see that impacting on the quality of care, then we will be coming out, and in terms of some of those thematic statements that we make, we will be coming out and making those statements.
Finally, the issue around new care standards has been kicking around for forever, seemingly. What is the delay in the new standards coming forward? And then, on the back of that, this committee has a priority of looking at health inequalities and reducing health inequalities. How will the new standards impact on health inequality?
Okay, thank you. In relation to the work, the care inspectorate was asked around the end of 2014 to work with Healthcare Improvement Scotland to develop the new set of national care standards. We initially developed a set of principles that were consulted on very broadly across the whole of Scotland. I think we had over 1,700 consultation responses, which was absolutely fantastic. The principles were agreed and signed off by the Cabinet Secretary. We have then commenced a period of wide consultation and involvement of a whole range of both organisations and, more importantly, individuals experiencing care in terms of what the new national care standards should look like. They're out for consultation. The consultation actually closes on the 22nd of January. In terms of the point about how will these address health and, I would hope, social inequalities, the new national care standards are perhaps, in my opinion, the most radical and progressive set of standards that we have seen, not just in Scotland, not just in the UK, but actually across the whole of Europe. And the reason that I say that is we have moved to a position of, rather than having 23 standards that perhaps start off with saying you should receive, they're actually written from the perspective of an individual, I experience, and that's a significant difference. So we no longer have 23 standards, and I think it was 2,402 indicators, and we now have 4 general standards and 3 for specific groups of people, and around 177 statements in total. So it makes it much more simple, much easier to understand in terms of the quality of care that I, as an individual, should receive, and therefore makes it much more simple to actually expand on where we're not seeing high quality care, or indeed where through our strategic and our regulated care scrutiny work, we're seeing inequalities and be able to report on those publicly.
And how will those standards impact on inequality?
In terms of the standards themselves, they will impact on inequality quite simply because we'll be able to aggregate what we're seeing in terms of individual experiences across Scotland, be able to aggregate those up using our intelligence. And if I might give a very practical example of that, we will be able to evidence the quality of care an individual receives, regardless of care setting. We'll be able to correlate that in terms of the Integrated Joint Board or working with partners in the Integrated Joint Board right down to postcode level. So in future, we should have a much more mature and sophisticated range of intelligence that tells us, for example, in what postcode area are people presenting most to their GPs. That will give us really robust information. Equally so, we'll be able to use that from a children's perspective in terms of looked after children, children on the Child Protection Register, that type of thing. So I am absolutely confident that they will go a long way to addressing health and social inequalities across Scotland.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I now suspend briefly for the change of panel, and thank you for your attendance. The eighth item on the agenda is consideration of a legislative consent memorandum from the Scottish Government on health service medical supplies cost bill. Can I welcome to the committee Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport, Rosemary Parr, Chief Pharmaceutical Officer, and Martin Moffat from the OOS Advisor, Policy Advisor on Pharmacy and Medicines Division, All Scottish Government. Welcome to the committee. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to make an opening statement?
Well, thanks, Convener, and thanks for the invitation to speak to the committee today. I'm grateful to the committee for taking the time to consider this important legislative consent motion regarding the information powers proposed in the Health Service Medical Supplies Costs Bill, especially given the challenging timescales surrounding the passage of the bill. We all have a shared responsibility to deliver value for money within our public services and to look at every opportunity to better control costs, and healthcare is no exception. Medicines are by far the most common form of healthcare intervention used by clinicians. In 2015-16, the NHS in Scotland spent a total of some £1.67 billion on medicines and appliances, approximately 13.6% of the total healthcare budget. In primary care alone, the gross costs of drugs and appliances dispensed increased by over 14% between 2006-07 and 2015-16. With advances in science and our ageing population, these costs can only continue to grow. The measures in this bill will enable the four UK administrations to secure better value for money for the NHS from its spend on medicines and other health service medical supplies. The information powers, which are the focus of the legislative consent motion, are a key plank of the bill and will be instrumental in achieving its aim to better control the costs of health service medical supplies and, in particular, medicines. They will augment the existing quarterly drug pricing inquiry survey in Scotland, which we conduct through the provisions made in the NHS Pharmaceutical Services Scotland regulations, and will help to provide greater transparency and insight for the Scottish Government and NHS Scotland on the costs of health service products. They will help to evaluate whether the supply chain or specific products deliver value for money and control costs, and assess whether adequate supplies of health service products are available for the health service. In particular, the information powers will open up access to information on sales and purchases of health service medicines and other medical supplies from other parts of the supply chain, particularly manufacturers and wholesalers. Through the development of memorandum of understanding arrangements, the powers will allow the UK government and devolved administrations to work together to access and share data on more products and from more parts of the supply chain, as well as collaboration on health service costs. This approach offers a more streamlined framework for application of the information powers and reduces duplication of effort across the four UK countries. Data requirements on UK suppliers of health service products will be set out in regulations. The process of developing these regulations, including consultation with stakeholders and the impact assessment, will ensure that data requests put the minimal burden on industry, while ensuring that the government has the information it needs to make decisions on health service medicines and other medical supplies. Subject to the passage of the bill through the UK Parliament, it is anticipated that the consultation on regulations will take place over spring and summer of this year for commencement in autumn of this year. Happy to take any questions from the committee.
Okay, Richard.
Thank you, convener. Reading through this, I was quite astounded. Basically, and if I can pick parts here, there are two systems, there's a statutory scheme and there's a voluntary pharmaceutical price regulation scheme, PPRS, that shows that a number of single-source, unbranded generic medicine manufacturers have recently been able to significantly increase prices by often by over 1,000%. 1,000%, is that the case?
In some cases, yes, it has been, and I think one of the important elements of this is to look at how costs can be controlled. That's the whole purpose of this LCM. Martin, do you want to say a little bit about the PPRS and the statutory schemes and the relationship? Yes. Do you want a little bit more detail?
In terms of the PPRS, which is a voluntary scheme, and the compared with the statutory scheme, what the bill aims to do is to create a level playing field between the two and prevent switching, so that we can have a far greater insight and control over how costs of drugs are investigated and examined, and how we can help to control the cost of drugs. The drugs that we are talking about in specifically here are in relation to unbranded medicines that wouldn't naturally fall under either the voluntary scheme or the regulated scheme, because those focus on branded medicines. So as soon as something comes off patent or the license is sold on and is marketed as a generic drug, then it falls outside the scope of either the statutory or the regulatory schemes. And what the bill aims to do is to close that gap.
So I'm right in saying that the UK government have this as a reserved matter. The Scottish government don't set the prices. UK government set the prices. Bear with me. But when this came out, the original clause only applied to England, which is contained within this paper, and also basically following agreement between the Department of Health and Scottish government, we finally got this resolved. But basically, we had a situation where they also had it in Clause 9. I just love this. Clause 9 of the information regulation states that all English producers must keep the following information, all English health service medicines, and produce it when requested by the Secretary of State, names of buyers and sellers. So we're being asked to resolve this by next week. But basically, prior to this, it was only England that was in this, and then they suddenly realised, oops, we've got to add other people in so they've now amended it to include us. Is that correct?
Yes, the bill is largely predicated on the reserved matters around price regulation, but after discussion across the four countries concerned, it was agreed that the best way and the most practical way of looking at this was to involve all the four countries across the UK about how we can better monitor cost of drugs and control the cost of drugs. And one of the things that we wanted to make sure was is that because of the nature of the way industry is, particularly manufacturers and wholesalers, they're UK in character. And it was thought that rather than having taken a separate approach, that we would work together in order to have a more aligned approach to managing costs.
Last question, convener. Was it previously the case ever that drug manufacturers were charging a price down in England, a price in Wales, a price in Northern Ireland, a price in Scotland, different prices, or have we not found that?
I mean, obviously, some of that information is quite hard to ascertain, but I think there is evidence that I think we're talking more now about when medicines are brought through the various systems, so SMC, NICE, etc. I think it's fair to say that the offer that's put forward by pharmaceutical companies is quite often different to different health services. That's not just the case in the UK, but will be the case in other countries as well. But I suppose it's more marked when it's across the four devolved nations. Rosemary, we're on a slightly different issue, but...
Yeah, I mean, I think generally when we are talking about the costs of medicines, I think that is right. Our health services are treated separately. But we do have that close relationship with the UK, and as Martin's already said, I think that issue around the wholesalers is very important, and that supply chain, which is mostly UK-based. But yeah, I think it's up for us now to come back to this particular piece of legislation to get the best, I think, that Scottish Government and the NHS can do for the price of drugs and to stop maybe some of the areas where it wasn't a level playing ground.
So last question. This LCM will stop that practice?
Issue of, as Martin was laying out, about the issue of the generic unbranded medicines and making sure that action can be taken around some of the issues you cited, the 1,000% increase. What you were then moving on to, though, was more of an issue about when drugs are brought through the approval systems and the price that the companies offer, that can be different to different health systems. I think what's important there is that our health system and our approval process through the Scottish Medicines Consortium tries to achieve the best price and the fairest price. And I do think there is a responsibility on the pharmaceutical industry to offer best price. Now, some of the changes that the Montgomery Review has brought forward, I think, will help the Scottish Medicines Consortium be able to have more options around, perhaps, for example, putting a product out into the market for a period of time to test the clinical evidence around that, and also involving National Services Scotland in helping to be more robust around the price negotiation at an earlier stage. What we want is for patients in Scotland to get access to medicines as quickly as possible, and we want the health service to get the best price and deal around those medicines. And I think the SMC changes that have been the recommendations that I've approved will help to do that.
Thank you.
Can I ask, why are we regulating? Why are medicines regulated under two systems, two codes, voluntary and non-voluntary?
And the statutory.
I suppose it's easier maybe to say that the PPRS is something that's been a UK government issue for a long time, and it only really comes to the control around branded medicines. So that's a particular type of drug that obviously is not the same as the generic medicines, which is what we're trying to get that level playing field for here. And it's a payment mechanism that companies pay back payments to the Department of Health based on, I suppose, their aspects of sales as well. So I think this bill amends it back to make, without no doubt, that the purpose of both schemes will actually now have that level playing field to allow us to look at both. But historically, it has been done on a UK level and looking at different aspects of both generic and branded medicines.
So I was just going to say, Kamira, I think it's also fair to say that the PPRS hasn't worked act as well as had been anticipated, which is why Jeremy Hunt's been in a round of negotiations with his health officials to try and secure a better deal. And there's work still going on that to try and get a better deal for 17-18 while other longer-term changes are made. Which obviously we have a very close interest in because the PPRS receipts are very, very important for the New Medicines Fund.
My experience of being in here for the last almost 6 years has been that I have been, and I'm sure other members have been, lobbied heavily by drugs companies and regularly, and I'm sure you people have yourself. And I have a real problem with the way in which the drugs companies do that, in that they come in, the conversation usually goes along these lines, but they'll come in and they'll say, we have this new drug. It's usually to deal with life-limiting conditions or very serious conditions that people have got. And they say, we want this onto the NHS system and it's going to provide such a difference for patients. And we really want your help or anybody else's help to get that through that system. And the question I always ask is, how much is it? And they take in a lot of breath through their teeth and they kind of shrug their shoulders and say, well, we'll get a good discount for the NHS. And then you say, how much is it? And then we get to it's 50,000 or it's 60,000 or it's 70,000. They never, ever, ever have lobbied me for anything that costs a fiver, a tenner or 20 quid. And I think there is a real problem with the way in which the drugs industry behaves in regards to dealing with government and dealing with the parliament and the way in which they try and promote the products. Because in some, you know, I actually think they are in many senses playing God there because they have the power to help people, but they engage in that game. Will this help us get away from that and actually see what the real cost of medicine is?
In some ways it will help in part, because it will actually bring back into line the companies, and the very minor, I suppose, number of companies who might actually be flipping between the different systems. So this will stop them doing that. And that's really where there's been a product, one particular drug, that maybe has come off patent, and then we've seen a huge price increases, maybe back to 1,000%. So that will absolutely be able to stop that. So I think that's a real benefit. But the bigger picture around medicines and supply and costs is a very difficult and complex area. And as Cabinet Secretary has said, we do have systems in Scotland that are looking at both clinical effectiveness and cost effectiveness. And that's really important, I think, for when we're looking at the whole population across Scotland and what is good, really, in medicines terms as that comes through. And then we've also got national procurement, I think, once those medicines are approved, to try and get the best and the most fair price there. But it will always be that discussion, I think, around that. We're working in the pharmaceutical industry is a global market, and they obviously look to the UK to be very important as part of that global market, and price is part of that as well. So I wouldn't like to say it would be the end of our difficulties or asking for a fair price. I think we'll need to continue to do that.
And I think the SMC Montgomery recommendations will help as well, because what we're looking for here is a fair price. We recognise that there's a lot of research and development costs that go into the development of these drugs, and obviously a lot of that is borne by the pharmaceutical industry. We recognise that. However, I think what we've seen through the SMC is that quite often when they come back a second time or a third time with a submission, there's a different price attached to that. And what we want to be able to get to system with involvement of NSS and others to try and get the best and fairest price early, so that we can get the drugs into the hands of patients at an earlier stage, rather than having this process of rejection and then resubmission with a better price. So if there could be a better price at resubmission, why couldn't there have been a better price first time round? So hopefully the Montgomery recommendations, which are, okay, separate from what we're talking about today, but nevertheless are going to be important, I think, in helping to get the drugs into the hands of patients more quickly, but at the fairest price. And that's what
this won't shed any light on how much that tube of ointment or that packet of pills costs to produce.
Most of the information we will always have is about what it costs the NHS. I think it's very difficult in that kind of global market to work out where the development costs and the marketing costs are, so difficult.
Hey, Marie.
Thank you, Convener. I guess I should declare an interest in that I'm a pharmacist registered with the General Pharmaceutical Council. like many of my colleagues, I'm really pleased to see this loophole being closed because, as highlighted in the Audit Scotland report for the NHS, it's galling to see the price of old drugs being hiked up because there's a small market and few alternatives. So I really welcome this. I don't want to be the defender of the pharmaceutical industry, but I note from their submission to us that they have some concerns about the data requirements, and I just wonder if you could expand a little about whether you think it's achievable what the bill is asking them to do in terms of extracting the information for individual generic drugs and extracting UK information out of the global information.
I don't think it's onerous, and a lot of the systems are already in place. So, and obviously note the concerns that have been raised, but we don't believe that these are, companies, for example, already required to keep information on sales and income for tax purposes for 6 years, and therefore the requirement to keep and record similar information under the information powers, I don't think will create a huge additional burden at all. I know the UK government's going to have develop an impact assessment for the regulations, which will hopefully take account of any concerns raised by industry. But Martin, anything you want to?
Yeah, just to add to what the Cabinet Secretary said, it's not really the intention to look at every product. It will be where there is a specific instance that may require further investigation around value for money for that product or for that product across the supply chain. It would be wholly unreasonable to collect that level of information on a routine basis. So what we would be looking for example, the best example that we can cite for that are the high-priced unbranded medicines. Mm-hmm. And gathering that information will help to open up some further intelligence about whether or not the prices that are being charged are justified, or whether they need to be amended in some way. But as Cabinet Secretary says, there's going to be consultation in all of this, and industry will have an opportunity to respond to that consultation and to look at any areas of practicality that may be a cause for concern and to try and address those through the consultation process.
Thank you. I wonder if I could ask a further question about the submission we got from the Royal College of General Practitioners. One of the dispensing doctors, I think, in that group submitted some concerns around the particular issue about pregabalin, which I suspect will not be tackled by this bill. So as I understand it, the pregabalin issue was that the licence for the generic drug didn't cover all of the indications that the licence for the proprietary drug did cover. Is that loophole likely to be closed by this bill, or are we going to need further legislation to tackle that type?
Need further legislation, but we would have to be quite clear up front that there is an issue around pregabalin that's been subject to judicial review and appeal process. So I think that in terms of getting into the detail of that at this stage, we probably shouldn't. But I believe that once all of this has gone through a proper judicial review process, then there will be opportunity to re-look at the prices that have being associated with drugs like pregabalin and to try and make sure that those costs are better controlled.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? No? Thank you very much for your attendance this morning, and we now move into private session.